Let's talk about what's called simplifying complex fractions. So first of all, I'd like you to please review the video, Finding the LCD of Rational Expressions. Most of what we do with rational expressions is going to involve finding the LCD. So this is really important as background for what we're going to talk about now. So we're going to first divide what we're talking about into two cases. And the first case, case one, that's going to be when, as we're going to see, the numerator or the denominator has a sum, has no sum or difference. Okay, so when there is no sum or difference in the numerator or denominator. Okay, case two is going to be when there is a sum or difference in the numerator or the denominator, okay? So when there is a sum or difference in the numerator or denominator. So the way we're going to handle the first case is we're going to what I'm going to call flip and multiply. And the way we're going to handle the second case, and the second case is by far the most important or the more important of the two cases, we're going to clear fractions using the LCD. And that's why I want you to go ahead and review the video, Finding the LCD of Rational Expressions, prior to what we're doing now. Okay, let's see examples of these two cases now. Okay, first let's simplify this complex fraction. Now, first of all, this is called a complex fraction because there is a fraction in either the numerator or the denominator. In this case, both, right? So a complex fraction is one where there's a fraction within a fraction, basically. And this is case one because there's no sum or difference in the numerator or the denominator. And I can see that because there's no addition sign or subtraction in either the numerator or the denominator. Okay, so what we do is we flip and then multiply. Now, what I mean by that is you just write this out, first of all, like, you know, if you read this, you'd say this fraction divided by this fraction. We're going to simply write that out horizontally. So we're going to first write it as 25x squared over 16y cubed, and then divided by the second rational expression, which is 15x cubed over 8y. Okay, and then the way you handle this, of course, is you change this to multiplication and then take the reciprocal of the second expression. And that's what I mean by flipping and then multiplying. So you leave the first one alone, of course, 25x squared over 16y cubed. And then you change the operation to multiplication, and you take the reciprocal of the second one, 8y divided by 15x cubed. Now, whenever you multiply two rational expressions, you always want to see if you can cross-cancel. And I can in this case, right? Let's see, 5 goes into both of these. So 5 goes into 15 three times. 5 goes into 25 five times. And 8 goes into 8 once. And 8 goes into 16 twice. And as far as the coefficients in the numerator are concerned, well, it's just 5 times 1, right? So the coefficient in the numerator is going to be a 5. And in the denominator, 2 times 3 is 6. And now what about the variables? Well, let's see, x squared completely cancels with two x's down here. So I'm left with just an x in the denominator. And as far as the y's are concerned, it's y and y cubed. Well, this y cancels, and I'm left with just y squared in the denominator. So that would be my answer for this one. 5 over 6 times, or 5 divided by 6xy squared. I can't cancel any further. Okay. Let's see an example now of case two, where you have a sum or difference in the numerator or the denominator. Okay, so here I see subtraction, right? I see it both in the numerator and the denominator. So the way case 2 works is you want to first find an LCD. Now what I mean by that is you first identify what I call the little fractions, okay? Little fractions are fractions that have little fraction bars. So this is a little fraction bar compared to a big fraction bar, right? So how many little fractions do I see? Only one. So you find the LCD of those little fractions. Well, in this case, because there's only one little fraction, the LCD would just simply be X. In the next example, we're going to see a situation where we have more than one little fraction, in which case the LCD is going to be more complicated. Okay, once you find that LCD, now what you do is you multiply the numerator and denominator of the big fraction by the LCD. So put parentheses around the numerator and the LCD over 1, and the same thing with the denominator, LCD over 1. Because it's subtraction here, we have to take that x and we have to distribute it, right? So it first gets multiplied by 3 over x and then multiplied by 2. Now when you multiply x over 1 by 3 over x, the x's are going to cancel. Do you see that? And you're going to be left with just the 3 and then minus, right? 2 times x is just 2x. And in the denominator, it's going to be x times x minus 2. Now there's no fraction to be cleared in the denominator. So when that's the case, we usually just leave it factored, x times x minus 2 in this case. That is, we don't actually distribute it. And the reason is because you really only distribute when you're trying to clear a fraction. If there's no fraction to be cleared, the advantage, like here, of leaving it factored is that you sometimes, not in this case, but sometimes, you're able to cancel. And what we'll see in the future is that sometimes the numerator and the denominator have factors in common. And if you leave it as a product, then it's already in a state where it might be able to be canceled. Okay? So in this case, no cancellation can be done, so this would be my answer. Okay, let's try another one similar in spirit to that one. Okay, let's simplify this. Now, first of all, this would certainly be case 2, right? Because I have addition and subtraction in the numerator and the denominator. Now, how many little fractions do you see? Well, little fractions are identified with little fraction bars. So I see 1, 2, 3, 4 little fractions. So you take all their denominators. So I take x squared, x, x, and x squared. Let's write those off to the side. X squared, x, x, and x squared again. And when you build the LCD, remember, it's always a comparison issue. So in this case, I see 2x's, 1x, 1x, 2x's, and you take the maximum number of those factors that you see in any one of these. That would simply be x squared. You don't want to multiply all these together. That's not how it goes when you're finding the LCD. Now, what you do with the LCD is just like what you did with the LCD in the previous example. You put big parentheses around that numerator, and you write x squared over 1 on the outside. Same thing with the whole denominator. Big parentheses and an x squared over 1. Okay, and then because it's addition, you want to take that x squared and distribute it. And when you multiply x squared over 1 by 10 over x squared, do you see the x squareds are going to cancel? And you're going to just have that 10 remaining. So it's going to be 10 plus, and then you move on to the next one. 7 over x times x squared over 1. Now, 1x cancels with 1x here, but you still have 1x left over after that, and that gets multiplied by the 7. So you've got a 7x, and then plus x squared times 1 is just x squared. Okay, then all over, well, x squared times 1 is x squared, and then minus 1x here cancels with 1x there. That remaining x gets multiplied by the 1, so x, and then minus. Now the x squareds completely cancel, and you're left with just the 6 up in the numerator. Okay, now it turns out you can simplify this, but you don't want to cancel these x squareds, and the reason is because it's addition and subtraction. You have to first factor the numerators and the numerator and the denominator. That numerator is a trinomial, and it can be factored as x plus 2 times x plus 5. And do you see how that denominator can be factored? that can be factored as x minus 3 times x plus 2. Okay, now that you have the numerator and denominator factored, now you can cancel, right? The factor of x plus 2 cancels with the factor of x plus 2 in the denominator, and you're left with x plus 5 divided by x minus 3. And now, of course, these x's don't cancel because it's addition and subtraction. So this would be your final answer. Okay, let's try another one like that. Okay, now when I look at this problem, you might be, or when you look at this, you might be tempted to say to yourself, well, I see a negative exponent, and that means I can take the expression into the denominator, right? Now that would only work if you had something like this, x to the negative second, y to the third, over, let's say, z to the fourth, okay? Now, in this problem, what I could do is this. I could write this as y cubed over x squared z to the fourth. So indeed, I could take this x to the negative second into the denominator and write it as x to the positive second, but that only works because it's multiplication. There's really an unwritten multiplication symbol right there. If it's not multiplication, like here it's subtraction and addition, you can't do this. You can't bring it straight down like that. But what we can do is acknowledge that x to the negative first is 1 over x, and then minus, same thing with y to the negative first, right? It's 1 over y. That's all in the numerator. And in the denominator, same thing, right? It's 1 over x plus 1 over y. And now actually I can see why this problem is in this section, right? Because I can now clearly see that this is a complex fraction. That is, I have fractions within a fraction. Okay, the LCD for this one, I can see it is gonna be x multiplied by y. So I multiply the whole numerator by xy over 1. And same thing with the whole denominator, xy over 1. Don't forget to put large parentheses like I did for the numerator and the denominator. That can really make a difference with how the problem looks to your mind's eye. Okay, now it's subtraction here, right? So we're going to take that xy over 1 and we're going to distribute it. And do you see the x's are going to cancel? When you do that, you're going to be left with y multiplied by 1, which is just y, and then minus. Here, when you multiply these together, the y's are going to cancel. And x, you're going to have the x remaining times 1. So it's going to be x, and then over. Now, because it's addition right here, this xy is going to be distributed. Again, the x's are going to cancel, and you're going to have y times 1, or y, and then plus. And then when you multiply these together, the y's are going to cancel, and you'll have x times 1 and just x. Now, of course, we can't cancel here because it's subtraction and addition once again, so this would be our final answer. Okay, let's try one more because these are so important. Okay, let's simplify this complex fraction. And the first thing we want to do, of course, is, you know, ask ourselves, which case are we in? We're in case 2 because I see subtraction in the denominator. So what we do is we take the denominators and we factor them to find an LCD. So it's going to be x squared plus 3x plus 2, right? That's one little denominator. Here's another little denominator, x plus 1. And then another little denominator, x plus 2. Okay, now this can be factored as x plus 2 times x plus 1. Now this, of course, is prime, right? Just x plus 1. And the same thing with this one. This is prime, x plus 2. So my LCD is going to be, well, I think about x plus 1's first. One factor of x plus 1, one factor of x plus 1, no factors of x plus 1. So I put in the maximum, which is x plus 1. And as far as x plus 2's, same idea. One factor of x plus 2, none, one here, so you have to put in one factor of x plus 2. Okay, then what you do, just like before, is you multiply the entire numerator by the LCD. That is the x plus 1 times x plus 2. So x plus 1 times x plus 2, right? And we usually write that over 1. And the same thing with the denominator. It's going to be x plus 1 times x plus 2 over 1. Okay, now, in the numerator, do you see how x squared plus 3x plus 2 is the same thing as x plus 1 times x plus 2? How do I know that? Because look, over here, x squared plus 3x plus 2 is factored as x plus 2 times x plus 1. So this is the same thing as that product. In other words, all of this is going to cancel with all of that. That's pretty nice, right? And I'm left with just x over 1, which is just x in the numerator. And in the denominator, it's subtraction. So when I take this and I distribute it, do you see the x plus 1 canceling with the x plus 1 right here? What you're going to be left with is 3 times the x plus 2 that didn't cancel. So it'll be 3 times x plus 2, and then minus. Well, now when you multiply these together, the x plus 2's cancel, and you're going to have 2 multiplied by that x plus 1. All right, let's extend this a little bit. And it's going to be x over, well, let's take the 3 and distribute it, and the same thing with the negative 2. So 3x plus 6 minus 2x minus 2, and then combining like terms in the denominator, we've got x over, well, it's going to be x plus 4. And of course, these x's don't cancel because it's addition right there. Okay, so this would be our answer. So what we've seen is that when we're simplifying complex fractions, there are lots of different types of scenarios we can run into, and most of the time we have to find an LCD for the little fractions. Okay, until next time.